Hello, here we are with another session of Microbiota and Cancer. At this moment, we are very pleased to discuss and talk about this fantastic subject with Professor Jeremy Burton. Professor Jeremy Burton is the senior author of the paper we will discuss that was just published in Nature Communications. He is from the Department of Microbiology and Immunology from the University of Western Ontario, London, Canada. Hello, Professor Jeremy. How are you doing today?
Hello, and thank you very much for having me on today.
Please tell us a bit about your investigation. You just told me you were from New Zealand, and now you are in Canada as a professor. So what is the story behind this?
So I left New Zealand to follow my love of microbiota science. So I've established a laboratory here in Canada. And a lot of the work that we do is related to urology. So kidney stones, urinary tract infection, and obviously now cancer and other things, which is the subject of the paper, obviously. But, you know, because we do microbiota analysis and other microbiology work, we've also been brought into some other programs here at the hospital, including the fecal transplant program. So we've run studies on fecal transplant, which is routinely done here for current C. difficile infection. We've done studies with non-alcoholic fatty liver disease and MS. So we're very much interested in microbes and really their role in human health. And, you know, it's getting to the stage where now we must almost consider the microbes, especially within the gastrointestinal tract, almost an organ in its own right. So our research is a little diverse, but it all revolves around the microbiota. Most is around urology, but we do dabble in many things, including fermented foods, as you know, potentially as a therapy for some of these conditions.
Very nice, very nice. Well, you have and your collaborators have published a paper which name is Abiraterone Acetate Preferentially Enriches for the Gut Commensal Akkermansia Muciniphila in Castrate-Resistant Prostate Cancer Patients. And now I understand the answer to my first questions, that would be why you have decided to study prostate cancer and intestinal microbiota. Is that because you work in a urology department as well? Or there was a hint, an idea that this could be some kind of association?
It was really an accident on several fronts that we ended up, you know, studying this. Well, so I am in a urology division, and I am a resource for all of urology, and urology is actually obviously a diverse profession in its own right. And we started studying prostate cancer because it was one of the most common conditions that the division sees here in Canada. But the reason why we started studying it is because we had a totally different theory. And the theory was that we thought that men were becoming resistant to their prostate cancer therapy, which is androgen deprivation, because we thought that bacteria might be producing androgens themselves and overcoming that androgen deprivation therapy that the men were receiving. So that's why we actually started studying the microbiome in this cohort. So we started studying it because there was groups in the United States which showed that certain Clostridium could actually produce androgens from corticosteroids. And corticosteroids are often given with some of these androgen deprivation therapies, especially abiraterone acetate. So we set off to investigate this for this reason. And I can elaborate a little bit more on the story if you like here. So, you know, we conducted a study and we recruited men that were receiving either no therapy, they had, you know, their prostate removed by surgery, or they're getting radiation therapy. Men that were still just on their normal androgen deprivation therapy, or men that were on androgen deprivation therapy plus abiraterone acetate. So abiraterone acetate is something that they usually give to men that have become castrate resistant. But the mechanisms involved are clear for some of the way that the drug works, in that it inhibits the biosynthesis of androgen production, but it still works to some degree in men that whose cancer is not sensitive to testosterone. So there was a gap in the knowledge there, but we really went to look at these men because we thought that we would find an overabundance of microorganisms that were producing androgens. Now, we did find some that were producing androgens, but not any more than in any other group. And, you know, that's another study that we'll be looking at. But really, our findings that akkermensia were heavily promoted in the abiraterone group was really serendipity. It was an accidental discovery.
Well, this brings me to my second question, that exactly what you mentioned. You have found that the treatment with oral abiraterone may promote the growing of akkermensia muciniphila. So what are the benefits this association brings to prostate cancer treatment?
Yeah, so, you know, we do work, you know, in anaerobic microbiology, and we were aware of the benefits of akkermensia. So akkermensia is really regarded as an important microorganism at the moment in a number of conditions. So probably the most well-known, it's implicated in the ability to modulate, you know, weight and diabetes and conditions like that. We know that it has a role in this. We know people have done studies that when they give akkermensia to obese people, that they can lower the weight of people, and also shown in animal models that, you know, akkermensia plays a key role in, you know, human and mammalian metabolism. So that's one particular area that was of interest. And with cancer, people that are using checkpoint inhibitor therapy, so immune therapeutics. So a lot of people, there's been studies that have been shown that if you're having a therapy like anti-PD-1 therapy to be successful, you need a microbiota which is unique and usually has akkermensia present in that microbiota. So people have been interested in stimulating akkermensia to get these beneficial health outcomes, which we perceive are beneficial health outcomes. Certainly that there are some studies that support this, but it's early days with regards to that evidence. But certainly with positive responses, you see akkermensia present. So with regards to prostate cancer, that there's a number of potential reasons why akkermensia could be beneficial. And one reason we thought of is that actually it seems to be a really early responder, chief regulator of what goes on in the rest of the microbiota. So we're still learning about this, but one thing it seemed to do is stimulate vitamin K2 menaquinone production, which so I'm not a nutritional expert like yourself, but having a quick read of the literature, we know that vitamin K2 and the various menaquinone derivatives, you know, are critically important in health. We know that they're involved in the way that calcium is deposited into organs, you know, soft tissues, bones, that sort of thing. So that can be a beneficial thing and it can be a detrimental thing. So there are some studies which show benefit to prostate cancer patients with vitamin K2 to some degree. So we really noticed a significant increase in the production of the microbes associated with some of these microbial sources of vitamin K2, which we think is important. So that's one potential way that we think that it works.
Very nice, very nice. I am a fan of Akkermansia muciniculae. You know, I know that in France, they are trying to, they have published, Cani and his group from Belgium also, they have published a postbiotic effect of Akkermansia, you know, so because it's very difficult to cultivate and to keep it as a probiotic. But in the future, maybe we'll have Akkermansia. But there is one question. You know, as you study gut microbiota, we always say we need diversity. We need richness. No? Then it called my attention that the intestinal microbiota diversity was higher in prostate cancer patients compared to normal, but lower in the ADT plus AA samples. I mean the androgen deprivation therapy together with the abiraterone. So could you comment on these findings?
Yeah, so I think that, you know, diversity, some of us have very defined understanding of it. Some of us have different understanding of it. So diversity, you know, we know that it's important to have a diverse microbiota for human health. And we did a study in China a few years ago, which showed this, that if you wanted to live to 100 years of age, you had a very diverse microbiota. In this particular case, what's pushing that diversity down in our analysis, we think, is that because we're increasing Akkermansia so much that, you know, the measurement of diversity is being pushed down the way that it's defined by microbiota analysis. So the Akkermansia becomes a lot more dominant than it, you know, usually is. And that's probably due to the feeding of the abiraterone.
Yes, that's very interesting, this, your idea about Akkermansia predominance and decrease of diversity, which makes totally sense. Now, for myself, I have to admit, to tell you that there was, in your paper, it's not one paper, many experiments, fantastic experiments. One of them was an assay of acetate of abiraterone and Akkermansia muciniculae. And you have observed that supplementation of growth media with sodium acetate elicited a near identical growth response in Akkermansia. Considering the benefits of Akkermansia, not specifically in prostate cancer, but overall, would you suggest us to give or to use oral acetate when fecal levels of Akkermansia are low?
So you've hit the nail on the head. This, to me, this is the most exciting part of the work by a long way. And so if I just take you back to abiraterone acetate. So abiraterone acetate is very insoluble. You know, 90% of it goes out in the feces. It's, you know, very unavailable to the host. So it's spending a lot of time within the gastrointestinal tract and with the microbiota. So the only way to access that abiraterone acetate is for the microbe to cleave it off and utilize it. So I would agree with you that supplementing with acetate might provide a benefit, but actually half the story is the delivery of acetate. So that acetate, if we were just to take it in its free form, as we would in vinegar or apple cider vinegar that people take, I think that we'd probably absorb that before it got to the colon. So we wouldn't be able to stimulate those Akkermansia. What we've done here is that we've accidentally found that if we can get the acetate chew the colon in a sort of a conjugated form where the microbes can use it and use it at their discretion, well, that greatly stimulates, you know, organisms like the Echinacea and others that get a benefit from that. So, you know, delivering acetate to the colon is the real challenge. So how do we do that? Do we put it into barrier capsules, you know, acetate into capsules that release in the colon? Or, you know, we don't want to give abiraterone acetate because that's a drug that will have a number of side effects and it's not appropriate to deliver to people that aren't, you know, don't have prostate cancer. So we're putting a lot of thought into that at the moment. So, you know, acetate is in so many foods, including fermented foods. So some of those fermented foods are easily digested, but some, you know, contain dense fibers. And we wonder whether the acetate during fermentation of that food goes deep into the fibers and may be released later on in the colon. So there could be a number of ways to deliver this. So I'm hoping to see some creative things come out of this research with regards to delivery of acetate. And it's certainly one thing that we definitely want to try. So we're going to look at slow release capsules to deliver acetate.
Yeah, acetate is a short chain fatty acid with two carbons. You can connect it with a glycerol molecule and you have a triglyceride. And then this triglyceride can be kept in a double capsule. You know, this double capsule is protected with FOS, and then it will open in the colon. It's like you prepare probiotics that you want to open in the colon. I mean, it's fascinating, the idea. You know, another nutrient that food that increases Akkermansia is cranberry.
Right, yeah. So with cranberry, so there's other options, right? So cranberry is rich in polyphenol, I think.
Yeah, of course.
And polyphenol, I think, stimulates Echinacea. The other thing is prebiotics. So you've got your conventional plant-based prebiotics, but now you're starting to see these new prebiotics from human milk oligosaccharides that they produce. And now, these are shown to promote bifidobacterium. And one of the major metabolic byproducts of bifidobacterium is acetic acid. So, you know, there could be a number of interesting strategies to try and boost the amount of acetate that we receive. So it could be dietary or prebiotic, fermented foods. You know, there's a number of potential ways. And it sort of gives us some mechanistic understanding why fermented food could be beneficial to us, because every culture on the planet has a history of using fermented foods.
Yeah, that's right. No, the science is trying and it's really explaining a lot of things that people were using, let's say, for centuries, but now we can better understand it. Well, you have touched lightly this topic, but if you don't mind, I would like to go back. There was a bacterially mediated enrichment of host vitamin K2, menachion, as you said, in this castrate-resistant prostate cancer patients treated with abiraterone. Why is this important? Is Akkermansia implied in the production of vitamin K2, or maybe we should just give vitamin K2 as an adjuvant to this cancer patient?
That's a very good point. So the way that we determined vitamin K2 was being produced more was by a genomics approach. So we could see that the organisms responsible for it were increasing. So it's a inferenced vitamin K2 increase. We know it's occurring, but Akkermansia produces, we think, some of the pathways for certain menaquinone variants. I can't remember off the top of my head what they were, but also it promoted other bacteria to produce different variants of the menaquinone. So we don't know which one of those variants are potentially important for human health. So, you know, I think there's about 10 or so different variants of menaquinone. So it's not only important to the host, but the menaquinone vitamin K2 is also involved in the electron transport chain of bacteria. So we think that they're actually sharing these between different bacteria as well to generate energy, and that maybe that bacteria aren't as selfish as we thought they were, that they're sharing a lot of these bioenergetic tools between each other to make energy. And some of our other research shows that with ATP and other areas as well.
So they would work in clusters of cooperation. Mm. That's right.
That's right.
But on the other hand, you also observe that with androgen deprivation therapy, depleted the another species, the Corynebacteria.
That's right.
And is do you think this because you stress this in your paper? So is this important?
We don't know if it's important. We're following up. So we found that androgen deprivation, whether just by normal therapy or with abiraterone acetate, in prostate cancer patients decreases those microbes. And those microbes are known to utilize androgen in as a nutrient source, for example. So that they become more depleted. Those particular microorganisms, they may be implicated in cancer. People have published papers suggesting that some of they're involved in interleukin 23 signaling, which apparently is important in tumorigenesis. So that could be another reason, why it's important to deplete those microbes. But we actually also noticed that the abiraterone itself could inhibit that microbe. And we're going to investigate whether the abiraterone, affects some of the enzymes involved in the breakdown of androgens that they might use as a nutrient source in further studies. So we think that maybe the abiraterone, also directly depletes those microbes as well.
Well, and then the question is this for good or no? So I mean, so we are approaching more or less the end of our interview, and I would like to, if you can tell us, what do you think you will be researching in this field in the future? What are your next plans?
So our next plans are to see if we can deliver acetate to the colon. So we've talked a little bit about this today. So we need to learn more whether we can get different, because there's many types of acetate. Some are widely used in foods, but maybe we absorb them quickly. But there's many, many different types of acetate conjugated to other things that we're interested in testing to see if there's one particular one that can be microbially unlocked in the colon. So that might be one particular thing that we're going to work on. I mentioned to do some studies delivering acetate in barrier release capsules. That's another study. We do a number of other studies with collaborators here. So I mentioned that we use FMT, fecal microbiota transplant. So we do that for non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. So we have access to, populations like that and diabetic populations that would love to test this, because some of these components are just food grade components that we can quickly deliver to large populations to see if there's a difference. So we'll track their microbiota, see if there's a difference. Another group of patients that we're working with is melanoma patients that are getting this immune checkpoint inhibitor that I mentioned, and they benefit from Acomensia too. So, we might look at those patients with, an acetate barrier capsule or something like that too. But, it could also be you know, recommending eating more fermented foods, looking at that, fermented foods and health outcomes. You know, we have some markers now. We know that vitamin K2 could be a good marker, and the blood might not be a great marker for that because the vitamin K2 is quickly absorbed where it's needed, but there might be other metabolites that we can look at. So we're starting to get some indicators of what we could look at that, you know, we're making an impact on the microbiota in a positive way, because really at the moment, you know, treatments like fecal microbiota transplant, people don't really know how they work. It's very crude. You know, in the future, you know, they may look to use individual components of that FMT, but really at the moment, we don't have a good idea of how they work, but they do work. And, you know, we use it routinely for infectious diseases purposes at this hospital, but wouldn't it be nice to just be able to use something like an acetate barrier capsule as an alternative?
Perfect. Now, maybe you would like to deliver, you know, our audience is basically oncologists.
Mm-hmm.
So, and they will be eager to know your message, how they can, let's say, improve Akkermansia in their patients. We discussed a bit about diet, but maybe you have a final message for us.
Yeah, I mean, there's good evidence that certain things increase Akkermansia. Akkermansia has certainly, been associated with positive health outcomes, whether that be in, metabolic type syndromes or certain cancer type conditions. So, you know, we're interested in boosting Akkermansia. So some things have already been shown to do that. So metformin use, for example, has been shown to increase Akkermansia. They're looking at repurposing that in other patients. But, you know, we know that polyphenols, can boost Akkermansia and certain prebiotics. So diet is likely to be important. So, you know, really recommending, the consumption of things high in polyphenols, certain berries, and that sort of thing, I would recommend, even though there are no proper randomized clinical trials in that area, it certainly wouldn't be something that would hurt the patient. So I certainly recommend, saying to the patients, you know, change your diet if you don't have a very good diet at the moment, and that can potentially help you.
Thank you so much for your time. When I read your paper, I was really astonished. I mean, this is really advancement of science. And I am sure that our oncologists will be delighted to know you by video. And maybe when you come to Brazil again, we'll have this pleasure personally. Professor Jeremy Burden, it was a really pleasure to interview this for OncoNews. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having me, and it's truly an honor to be here. Thank you.